Hello and welcome to this module 26 on manufacturing systems technology. The last module we were talking about the variant approach for doing the computer assisted process planning. In context of that, I would just like to mention that in the interest of time, I am sort of going ahead right now without delving into the details of group technology, but I'm going to actually do that mostly towards the end of the program when we are able to finish all the modules. One or two modules we'll spend on how to do group technology or how to do this part families. It's important for you to understand that how the CAPP system is able to identify on a, using a variant approach by looking at some of the subparts or part level families which have been made in context of their similarities of manufacturing systems or similarities of designs or similarities of functionalities. Okay. So as of now, we just go ahead and work on the different approach, that is the generative CAPP method, which we had earlier illustrated. So in this approach, process plans are generated by means of mostly, you know, it is first of all, it is generated ab initio, and they are generated by means of decision logic, formulas, some technology algorithms and geometry based data to perform uniquely the many processing decisions for converting parts from raw materials to a finished state. So we are trying to have a separate module where we are really not looking at the variant of an existing process or an existing part or existing family, but rather than trying to create an ab initio part from the geometry requirements that the part has and the processing requirements that the part has. And here we are using some very logical tools. Okay, so there are two major components of a generative process planning system. One is a geometry based coding scheme, and another is a process knowledge based scheme. And this process knowledge is typically arrived at very quickly through this decision logic and data and some tables and formats which are sort of helping the process to quickly identify and formulate knowledge about the process. Okay. Another issue here is that the process knowledge derived from the experts in the processes itself, okay, or the manufacturing operators who are actually there, or the supervisors who are actually there, that needs to be somehow tapped into the CAPP system, because then the CAPP would be really a true CAPP which would propose true solutions to real life problems. So the knowledge based system again has an additional advantage that such decision tables or data are mined for variety of different operations. There are rule based or condition based selections of different criterias. Let's say in case of a machining of a small shaft, the diameter may matter or the length may matter in terms of a decision of an extra support. Okay. So such variabilities are recorded as an operator knowledge into the CAPP system. So that's one very good advantage behind the generative CAPP process. So the process knowledge is a very critical component. So the geometry based coding scheme has a basic objective of defining all geometric features and for all process related surfaces, and that also with respect to the definition is with respect to the feature dimensions, the location of the particular feature or the part in the whole assembly or the whole design that is being considered, and the tolerances over which these parts are needed for the assembly to work functionally in an appropriate manner. So there are many aspects like feature dimensions, the location of the particular feature, the tolerances, and obviously surface finish also, which gives you an illustration of, you know, sort of fits between the different surfaces and assembly, etc. So these are all somehow obtained as a geometry level coding scheme or a geometry level information in this particular scheme. So the level of detail is much greater in a generative system than in a variant system, obviously, because a variant is more related to, okay, if we have an existing part geometry somewhere stored, we are just differentiating that in terms of the new requirement and the geometry existing. So that's only the plus delta data which gets needs to be mined there for determining a variant plan of the similar kind of a part family or a similar kind of a you know, subpart in question. But here in this case, it is a much more level of details, because every part needs to be in terms of its geometry, feature dimension, locations, tolerances, so on and so forth. Somehow a lot of data And there is no comparison between what is existing from the non-existing. So supposing if you are having many bolts or many nuts or many fasteners, each of them would be a separate data entity here. Okay, so that is a difference in this particular scheme. So obviously details such as the rough and finished states of the part, the process capability of the machine tools to transform these parts, etc., need to be provided. So all this data are entered as far as the geometry based coding systems are considered. So in the process knowledge based coding systems, the basic operation that needs to be carried out is the matching of part geometry requirements with the manufacturing capabilities. Okay, and that matching is the process knowledge, okay, which really gets translated. For example, let's say you have a option of choosing between three different machines for a particular surface finish or a particular tolerance level or a particular overall size related to the bed size of the machines, etc. So here the process knowledge is the knowledge derived as to, let's say if we want to make a shaft with a surface finish of 10 microns, we need to use a NC lathe for that, or we need to use machine X or machine Y or machine Z for that. So that kind of a knowledge is kind of embedded from the experiential approaches done by several operators who are there on the line handling the parts and the machines together, and this integrates into the CAPP system as the process knowledge data. Okay. So mostly the decisions are taken about a certain route planning for the CAPP system, that whether X machine or Y machine needs to be selected for a certain surface finish, certain dia, certain size of the shaft that we are considering, okay, by means of some kind of logic. Okay, and this logic is embedded in terms of some logic tables. Okay, and I'm going to consider one or two logic tables, and I'm going to show you how such process selections can happen. Okay, so all these steps related to process planning is automatically carried out. Obviously, examples include process selection, machine tool selection, tools, jigs and fixtures selection, material selection, inspection equipment selection, sequencing of the operations, and so on and so forth. Obviously, also setup and machining times are automatically calculated once these selections and choices have been made. And the operation instruction sheets are generated to help the operator to run the machine in case of manual systems. In case of automatic systems or NC systems, it goes through the NC programming route that the data gets into the CAM, as you saw earlier. And these routes are then obeyed by the particular CAM center in terms of machining control on the NC system which is present there. So let's look at the process knowledge method. We all know that manufacturing knowledge is really the key or the backbone in process planning, and it's not a one-time activity but a recurring dynamic phenomena. So experience over the past so many years have been coupled up somehow as process knowledge, and this knowledge is coming into the system. So the experience of manufacturing personnel, for example, can be in terms of the handbooks that they have over the machine tools, or the suppliers of major machine tools, or the tools, jigs or fixture materials, inspection equipments, customers. All this kind of a shared knowledge is called or is recalled when we talk about different sources of the manufacturing knowledge. And however, you have to have a good structure so that you can identify the useful from the useless, and only those important parts have to be considered when as far as the process knowledge goes here. Okay, so let's look at some decision trees and decision tables which we take as a practical example to illustrate that how you do the machine selection. Okay, so what is a decision table? So it provides a convenient way to document manufacturing knowledge. Let's say this kind of is a representation. So you have something called a condition, something called action here. There is a rule which is there. I'm going to explain each and every part of it in details through problem examples. So there are principal elements of all decision tables, and the elements of a decision table are conditions, okay, some actions and some rules. These are the three elements which are contained in a particular decision table. And obviously they are sort of organized as an allocation matrix, as you can see here. So this is more like a matrix type of an orientation that you have. And the word condition really means the goals, so the goal may be to turn a particular shaft of diameter so and so and length so and so to a certain tolerance level. So that is the overall condition or the goal of the manufacturing operation that needs to be planned, for example. So for that we need to achieve the actions stated for the operations so that we can perform the compliance of the goal that has been planned earlier. Okay. So the actions are those operations or those sequences of operations which are conditioned by certain governing rules, and the rules are based on the experience of the manufacturer personnel, so that the values here, entries, correspond to a certain condition or a certain action with respect to the certain rule. Let's look at it how. So let's say there are two different cases here. In one, we are trying to consider a Boolean time of entry in the particular decision table as shown here. The condition here that we consider is to drill a hole, and then from the rules we look for the rule that can be applied, and then from the rule we get the solution, something like that. So the overall condition is to drill a hole, and the hole is drilled in a bar which is let's say greater than or equal to 8 inches, okay, and the diameter of the bar is about less than 1 inches in one case, in another case it's greater than or equal to 1 inches, and the action that needs to be taken is an extra support which is provided for handling this particular bar for the drilling operation on a lathe. We are using the turning center for doing a drilling, so it's basically coming from the tailstock side and trying to drill the bar, and the question is whether you need or need not provide an extra support. So that is the action criteria that you are considering here, okay. So the rules have been set up in the following manner using Boolean type of representation, that if the length of the bar, let's say, is 8 inches, we represent this by a true value here, okay, meaning there that the length is 8 inches, and let's say the diameter is less than an inch, okay. So in that event, you will have to necessarily use the extra support, so there is a true value in the extra support. So the action has to be executed in this type. So what is the condition? The condition is basically to drill a hole, okay, in a particular bar which is 8 inches probably in diameter, okay, greater than or equal to 8 inches in diameter, in length, I'm sorry, and less than 1 inches in diameter, okay, and then you have a rule governing saying that if these two are the true values, then obviously you need an extra support for that. If supposing the length is less than 8 inches, so obviously the length of the bar in that case is false, okay, because the length is less than 8 inches, and you don't really care at that point if the length is less than 8 inches to provide or not to provide an extra support. So you are keeping this empty, the blank means here do not care. And similarly, if the diameter of the bar is, let's say, greater than or equal to 1 inches also, even if the diameter is high, we don't need to keep an extra support, or we really don't care if even whether it contains an extra support or not. Meaning thereby that there is a cutoff value we have illustrated here, that if the diameter of the bar is less than 8 inches or the length of the bar is less than 8 inches or the diameter of the bar is, let's say, greater than 1 inches also, we don't really care whether an extra support should be provided or not. So this is a logical representation in a decision table for the condition which is drilling a hole using a turning center, and you can see how with the true false entry you have represented the various rules here. The rule says only in case the length of the bar exceeds 8 inches and the diameter is less than 1 inch or so, you need to use extra support, otherwise we really are not worried about if the diameter is, if the length is less than 8 inches or if the, let's say, the diameter is greater than 1 inch, we really need not care whether the support is there or not. So in a logical way, you are representing using this decision table or logic table. There can be another way of representing the same thing using continuous value entries. Here it is more related to really the cutoff values beyond which the extra support would be needed, okay. But there can be some sub-values where there may or may not be the need of an extra support which gets carried out. For example, in this continuous value entry table, you see if the length of the bar is less than or equal to 4 inches and the diameter is greater than 0.2 inches, you're not worried about whether the extra support would be needed. However, if the diameter of the bar is less than or equal to 0.2 inches, you definitely would need an extra support. Obviously, if the bar is smaller and smaller, let's say from this value, the bar has gone to this particular value, so the providence of an extra support somewhere here is needed, otherwise there will be a bending or the sagging of the bar when you are doing machining, okay. So here also, for example, if the length of the bar is greater than or equal to 4 inches and the diameter is within 1 and 0.2 inches, again an extra support is needed. If the length of the bar is less than or equal to 16 inches and the diameter is greater than or equal to 1 inches, we don't care whether the support is to be provided. But however, if the length of the bar is greater than or equal to 16 inches, you do need an extra support as has been seen here. Okay. So this is various ways of representing the same problem. And the continuous value entries are more tougher, I would say, to represent the same condition as here. There is more of a cutoff representation in the Boolean type entries, but in the continuous value entries, there may be a lot more details than the Boolean type entries in terms of exactly what is the cutoff length or cutoff diameter beyond which you would be able to use an extra support for the manufacturing advantage of the particular system. So, this in a nutshell is what decision tables are. I'm going to represent a logic table in the next problem example, but I would like to do that in the next module. Thank you.